Two young ladies went down there in the middle of it yesterday to relieve the other two, and the kids were like, no, don't take these two away. And I thought, well, praise God. I mean, never mind. But anyway, so I'm thankful for Brother Mike.
Yes, sir.
And we're ready.
Good.
Here we go. Micah in the Word of God. And I know we have two preachers tonight. And let's stand together. We'll look at it. Micah chapter 6. And let's pray. Father, we love you. I thank you that I could be at this dear church tonight. Yes. Lord, I pray that you would speak to my heart.
Yep.
And the heart of these dear people. Lord, I know it's a Wednesday night, and some of them were here on Monday night and Tuesday night, and God, they're being faithful. I pray you'd give them strength if they're weary. I pray, Holy Spirit of God, that you would speak to hearts, Lord. Yes. And we will be sure to praise you for that.
Yes.
For you alone, God, are worthy of our praise. Thank you. We could sing to you, sing about you, sing for you, Lord. And I pray your blessing on the Word of God. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes. Micah chapter 6 and verse 8. He hath showed thee,
amen,
O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee? Micah says, this is what God requires of you.
Right.
This is what God expects of you. This is what God wants you to do and wants me to do. We're talking about revival.
Yeah.
But to do justly, do right, love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. Say, what's our requirement in life?
Come on now.
What does God want from us? Do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. You may be seated. You know, life can be complicated. We're living in a high-tech world, and some of you are like, I'm getting left behind quickly. I've got a guy on my staff, Brother Jason. He wants to do everything digitally. I mean, we sign up for everything digitally. I mean, he'll send me these emails that I'm supposed to confirm and sign up because I'm singing the lead part on the choir song on Sunday morning. You know, I'm thinking, what in the world is this about? What's this form about? And it's all the, I said, look, man, I need paper. I need old school. I'm an old guy. I'm not up with all. Life can be complicated, all right? And life can be difficult, and we get pulled all different directions. I love verses like Micah 6:8 that tell us really when you all boil it down. Well, what about my job? And what about my mortgage? And what about doing this? And what about doing that? And what about, God says, hold on.
Yeah. Yeah.
Do right.
Yeah.
Love mercy and walk with me. That's what I require of you. That's what I expect of you. And we're going to preach tonight on this subject, walking with God. Walking with God. And it may be called knowing God. If I said this to you, do you walk with God? Do you know God? We could call it being a friend of God, right? Fellowshipping with God. Whatever you call it, the question for us tonight is this. Are we walking with God? This is what's required of us. It's what's required of me to walk humbly with our God. Go, if you would, to Exodus chapter 3. We're just going to have 3 points tonight about walking with God. Ask yourself this question, do I walk with God? Could it be said, and God knows if you do or don't, but could it be said of your life that you walk with God? And let me say this, if you don't know the answer to that question, you're probably not walking with God. Well, Brother Mike, I don't really know if you'd say I'm walking with God. That's a good sign you're not walking with God. My daughter, Kayla, she'll be here last night, tomorrow night. She likes walking the dogs. I have two dogs that like to go on walks, Max and Mia. And she'll walk them together. And then whenever she gets the leashes out, the third dog, Macy, runs and hides. Macy does not like to go for walks. So she walks Max and Mia together, and she comes back in the house. Literally, Macy's hiding in the corner, and Kayla goes over and puts that little leash on. And then finally, Macy will go out, and she takes Macy on walks. If I said to Kayla, after she had taken the dogs out for a walk, I said, babe, did you walk the dogs? Her response to me, preacher, is not going to be, I'm not sure if I just walked the dogs. I mean, she just walked. I don't really know if you'd say I walked the. Hey, it's not this abstract thing. Either you walked them or you didn't.
Hey.
Tonight, let me say this to you. You either walk with God or you don't. It's not that confusing. I'll call my dad sometimes on the phone. I'll say, hey, Dad, what are you doing? I'm getting my coffee, and then I'm going to do my walking. That's what it says. Then I'm going to do my walking. And dad will walk and dad will pray. And he's a walker for his exercise. Here's the question for you, church. Do you walk with God? Well, Mike, I'm saved. No, I didn't ask you if you're saved.
Right.
Do you walk with God? Well, here I'm here on a Wednesday night. No. I didn't ask if you go to church. Do you walk with God?
That's good, dog.
Do I walk with God? Do the preachers walk with God? That's what's required of us.
Yeah.
Well, man, we want to have revival. Hey, we don't even think about it if we're not doing what's required of us, and that's to walk with God.
Yes.
Exodus chapter 3. We find Moses here as a 80-year-old man. And Moses, boy, you talk about going through some changes in his life. Moses went through changes in his life. His first 40 years, he was raised in a palace, right? His second 40 years, he wound up on the backside of the desert, right? But here we find Moses as an 80-year-old man, and he's getting ready to have an encounter with God. We're getting ready to see in Exodus chapter 3 where Moses, I believe, begins to walk more closely with God than he ever had before.
Yeah.
Do you want revival? You know, revival is really not that mysterious.
Right. That's right, brother.
It's like me saying, do you want to get in shape? It's well, tell me what you're eating. Tell me if you're exercising. Tell me. If you desire it, you can have it.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, man, we want revival, man. We want God to just kind of move it. He wants to move. I tell you, God already voted for us to have revival. It's us that's the problem, right?
Yes.
And so here's Moses, and he's going to walk more closely with God than he ever has. You know what would be awesome? If some of us start to walk closer to God than we did yesterday. We'd be on our way to revival. That'd be a great thing.
Yeah.
Look at Exodus chapter 3 and verse 1. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. Now Midian's in Saudi Arabia, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. So again, Moses spent the first 40 years of his life in royalty. He was the grandson of Pharaoh. I mean, he was an important guy. He lived in a palace. He went to the best of schools, wore the best of clothes. He had literally the best of everything. He was Moses. That was his life.
Yeah.
And Moses says on this particular day, you know what? I'm going to go see my brethren. It's amazing. He was raised in Egypt, but he knew he wasn't Egyptian.
Right. Yeah.
Hey, we live in this world, but if you're a child of God, you're not of this world.
Hey!
And you know it. And Moses said, I'm going to go see my brethren. And he winds up in Midian. And for 40 years, think about this, he's a shepherd. What happened to me being the royal kid? The kid living in the palace, the kid with the tutors, the kid with the I'm out here for 40 years in the backside of a desert being a shepherd. You talk about a total life change. It was a total life change. And on this particular day, he's keeping watch over his father-in-law's flock. And notice what happens here in verse 2. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked and beheld the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. We get used to this stuff.
Right.
He's walking through the desert.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden this bush is on fire. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. Hey, what's happening here? God is trying to get Moses' attention. There's not a lot going on in the desert. And so when he sees this bush on fire, it gets his attention. And when he notices that this bush is not consumed, it really gets his attention. And he says in verse 3, I will now turn aside and see this great sight. Moses said this, I want to see what this is all about. Moses wanted to see God. Moses wanted to see what God was doing. And so what he did is he said, I'm going to turn aside. Church, listen to me. If you want to know God, if you want to walk with God, it's going to involve first tonight. I'm going to give you three words. You're writing them down. Put this word down. Seeking.
Yeah.
It's going to involve seeking. Moses said this, I want to go and see what this is all about. And hey, if you're going to walk with God, you are going to have to seek Him. If you seek a closer walk with God, you can have it. If you do, James chapter 4 and verse 8, draw nigh to God and He will draw nigh to you. If you want to be close, you can be. And if you're going to walk with God, you are going to have to seek Him on purpose. Absolutely. Teen, are you walking with God? Hey, every teenager in the building, let me ask you, are you walking with God? You know if you are or not. Sir, are you walking with God? Again, I'm saved. That's not the question. Are you walking with God? College student, are you walking with God? Ma'am, are you walking with God? Senior, are you walking with God? You're going to have to seek Him if you're going to walk with Him. Look at Psalm chapter 14. Psalm chapter 14. I wonder how many people today are seeking God. How many people in this neighborhood, how many people in our country are seeking God? Look at Psalm 14. Notice what the Bible says here. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none that doeth good. Look at this. The Lord looked down from heaven upon the children of men to see if there were any that did understand and seek God. They are all gone aside. They are all together become filthy. Look at this. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. God looked down from heaven. He said, I wonder if I'm going to find anyone that is seeking me, that is taking time to seek me. Are you seeking God? You do a word search on that seek. Seek God, seek the Lord, seek God, seek the Lord. It's all throughout there.
Yes, sir.
And here Moses says, you know what? I'm going to go see this out. I'm going to go seek this out. I'm going to go get closer to this bush that represented God's presence there. I want to seek God. A while back, Travis came in my room. It was about 11:30 at night. I was laying there. I was actually reading. My door opens up. I'm like, what's going on? He's like, I'm looking for something. So what are you looking for? He's like, I lost my money. It's not really funny, but I thought, this kid's in a panic at 11:30 at night. He's like, did Mom do the laundry? I'm like, yeah, it's over there. So where's my gray pants? And he's looking through his, how many of you have been there before? You can't remember where it's at, right? And then out the door he goes. Then I hear the washer open. Then I hear the dryer door open, right? And I'm thinking, this kid's not going to sleep tonight until he lost his money, Brother Burton. And you know what he was doing? He was seeking it. He was seeking it. You hear the alarm bang, and the door open, and he goes looking everywhere. Where? I've lost my money. I've lost my money. Let me ask you this. Do you even come close to seeking God? God, I need you. God, where are you today? God, I want to be close to you today. God, I need you in my life. When's the last time you were looking for God? When's the last time you woke up and said, God, I'm looking for you today? When's the last time you've got your pen or your pencil out and it's morning and you open up the Word of God and you say, God, I'm seeking you in your Word. God, I'm on my knees, God, and I'm seeking you. Hey, if you're going to walk with God, it involves seeking. It involves seeking. You're going to have to seek God. Absolutely. Moses turned aside to where he saw God and he begins to seek God. Are you seeking God today? Are you walking with God? Not only does walking with God involve seeking, we see it also involves stopping. Notice this. He says first, I will now turn aside and see this great sight while the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush, and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. Not only does walking with God involve seeking, it also involves stopping. It involves stopping. Notice it says this, when the Lord saw that he turned aside, he stopped. He gave God his attention. God noticed, by the way, that Moses had stopped. Moses just didn't continue on his way. He stopped. He sought out God and he drew close to the bush, close to the presence of God. You understand, Moses could have kept walking on this day. He could have walked right by. Man, I got to get these. He could have been out there, honestly, and here he goes. I'm just watching these sheep and I got to get to the house. And well, look at that bush that's on fire. That is interesting. I've never seen anything, but man, I got to get to the house. I got to get going. And he didn't seek it out and he didn't stop because I've got all kinds of things that I've got to do. But it says this, he could have done that. And I wonder this, how many times has God, through a service, tried to get your attention? Hey, here I am. Look over here. Hey, slow down as you walk by in life. I'd like you to walk with me. How many times has God, through circumstances, tried to get your attention? Teenagers, how many camps have we been in? And God's, hey, I'm trying to get your attention. I wonder who even cares to seek me out. I wonder who's willing to stop and give me their attention. This is an awesome thing. When God saw that he stopped, and when God saw that he turned aside, Brother Burton, God then talked to Moses. God took a step. When he saw this person seeking him out and stopping, rather than just going on his way, God then spoke to Moses. First he saw the flame. Think about this. And now God is calling his name. That's an awesome thing. Moses. Moses. God wants to walk with you, but if you're going to walk with God, church, listen to me, you've got to stop. You've got to turn aside. And what's he say to him? Take off thy shoes. Look at this. He said, draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet, verse 5. For the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. You want to stand on holy ground? Can I say this to you? There's no holier ground than where God is. Here's the question. Are you willing to take your shoes off? Hey, there's no way he took his shoes off, Brother Burton, unless he stopped. He comes up and he gives God his attention. God's like, take your shoes off.
Yeah.
You take your shoes off in these days, you're not going far. You've hit the brakes. I'm standing here. I've got my shoes off. I'm not worried about moving. I'm worried about being right here and talking with you. And he takes his shoes off, no doubt out of respect because it's holy ground, but it's because he's standing still and giving God his attention. Getting to know God requires you to hold still. It requires you to seek God, but it also requires you to stop. And Moses did just that. And some of us say, you know what, I don't have time to stand still. I'm busy. I've got a lot going on. No time to stop and stand still and see God. Well, let me say this, then you're not going to walk with him.
Yeah,
right. Psalm 46:10, be still. And then what happens? And know that I'm God.
Hey.
Yeah, absolutely. Moses could have kept walking. Moses, you want to be on holy ground? You want to experience things like you've never experienced before? Hey, just take them shoes off, hit the brakes, and stay here with me. Be still right where you are. I'm afraid we've lost our ability to be still.
Come on.
I'm telling you, physically we can't be still.
Right.
We're just running. Yeah. We're addicted to activity.
Yeah.
We really are. And we're running physically, mentally. Our minds never stop. There's never been a generation quite like this to where we're plugged in all the time.
Right.
Spiritually, that affects us. And guess what? We've got a generation of young people coming up. They can't be still. And some of us older people know better. I mean, when our phone's not buzzing or ringing, we think it is. And we feel it.
Right.
You understand what I'm talking about? We sit down in a restaurant. Here, do this. Here, do this. Put this on. What? Hey, God says this. You need to be still.
Yes.
And Moses stopped. You understand that activity is often the enemy of spirituality? And I'm all for activity. But activity is often the enemy of spirituality. I'm talking about who in this room is really walking with God? Who can you say, like Trav, seeking that money? Man, I'm seeking God. I am on it. I'm drawing nigh. I want him in my life. Hey, I'm stopped and I'm being still. I'm in the Word. I'm on my knees. I'm all about it. Hey, do we just talk about walking with God? Or do we walk with God? Do we just talk about walking with God? Or do we walk with God? Kayla, did you walk the dogs? There's no question about it. She either did or she didn't. Did you walk with them today? Did you walk with them yesterday? You seeking them out? You sitting still? You stopping? Hey, you're not walking with them if you don't stop. That verse in Daniel that says, in the last days, what are men going to be doing? Running to and fro? Increasing in knowledge? Look, that's our generation, guys. Or smarter than we've ever been. We read that verse in Psalm. The fool has said in his heart, there's no God. By the way, get ready for that. We've got fake news all around us.
Right.
We cancel Dr. Seuss. We do this. We do that. Hey, people that believe in God, you're going to be the idiots next, and you're going to get canceled. No, there's still a God. He's still our Savior. That's never going to change. So just get ready for it. And that's a foolish heart that says there's no God. And we're supposed to be increasing in knowledge and smarter than we've ever been, and we're dumber than we've ever been in this nation. Because we are putting down God. But it says of the last generation, hey, they're going to be running to and fro. Not sitting still. Not knowing God. Here is Moses. And he begins to walk with God. What's he first do? He seeks God. He stops. And when the Lord saw that he had stopped, God then calls his name. He said, take your shoes off. You don't need them for a while. Just stay here for a little bit. Are you good at stopping? Not only if you're going to walk with God, you need to, number one, be seeking. Number two, you better get good at stopping. And number three, I see another word here, seclusion. Seclusion. He's 80 years old. The first verse of this chapter says he's on the backside of the desert. You say, Mike, when did Moses really get to know God? When he was alone.
Right.
When he was alone. That's when he came to know God. When is the last time you went to a secluded place so that you could walk with God? It's also called a secret place. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 6. What's the Bible talk about? Go into our closet to pray, right? That secret place, and walk with God. Let me just read it to you. Matthew 6 and verse 6. Here's what the Bible says. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret, and thy Father which seeth in secret. What's it talking about? That place where it's just you and him shall reward thee openly. Hey, when's the last time you went to that secluded place? I'm asking if you walk with God. Are you seeking Him? Well, Mike, I'm in the Word. I was in the Word today. I'm seeking God. I'm tracking God. God looked down from heaven and said, does anybody seek me anymore?
Yeah.
I'm a Christian. I'm saved. Are you walking with God?
Yeah.
Who's seeking God? Man, when Moses, he could have went by and said, man, how great was that? You know, that's what some people do at this revival meeting. Man, that was a great week, Brother Burton. They're just going to keep walking.
Right.
Look at what God did to our church. Look at the exciting songs. Look at the preaching. Look, wait, are you going to stop? Take your shoes off and say, hang on, God. I'm being still. I want to be close to you. And I can't just keep doing all that I've been doing. I'm not talking about things for God. I'm just talking about I'm running through life. I'm doing it. I don't know what it is that might have to stop you. And then, seclusion. Jesus is teaching his disciples that they need a secluded time with him, an alone time, a secret place, if they want to walk with God. Moses raised in royalty, again, the best of everything. Josephus tells us that he was a military general. And then he finds himself for 40 years walking in a desert. And it's in this secluded place that he gets to know God. Hey, I'm glad you're in church, but listen to me and don't take this wrong. I'll clarify it. You don't walk with God in church. It's part of the journey. It's part of walking with God. It's where we're supposed to be and gather. Yeah, but you don't walk with God in church. You walk with God in that secluded place.
Yeah.
You don't walk with God by giving out tracts, and I'm all for giving out tracts, Brother Burton. You know, I'm all for witnessing. I'm all, hey, Clark family, you don't walk with God when you're up here singing on the platform. That's service, that's good, coming to church. All we walk with God, listen to me, when we seek Him.
Amen.
We walk with God when we're still, when we stop. We walk with God in that secluded place, that private place. Have you been showing up? If you ignore the secluded place, if you neglect it, if you reject it, that quiet time, listen to me, you're not walking with God. Young people like to run. And I get it. Hey, teenagers, listen to me. You're going to have to learn to be still. I think of Jacob in the book of Genesis. Said, man, where did he really get with God alone? Nighttime at Bethel. And all of a sudden, he's in a quiet place by himself, being still. And his whole life changes. Moses, wandering out in the desert, here it is, by himself. Secluded place. Sir, ma'am, listen to me. We've got to shut out this world. And it could be your bedroom. It could be your car. It could be a closet. It could be out in the woods. It could be, if they have woods around here, all right. It could be whatever it is. And you're saying, it's just my quiet time. David, the man after God's own heart. You know what he's doing? He's out there with the sheep. He's got his harp, and it's him and God.
Yes, sir.
I'm talking about secluded places where it's you and God. Little Samuel, he's in his room by himself, and God calls his name. He runs into Eli, right? Comes back, runs in. You know the story. Said, where was Samuel when he started to walk by himself? Secluded place. John the Revelator. Man, we read about that. Where was he on the Isle of Patmos?
Right.
By himself. Hey, I love my family. I'm not happy, Miss Carla, for her not to be here. That's weird tonight. She wasn't able to be. I love when my kids are around. I love when my wife is around. But listen to me. We have got to be people that get alone with God. Who in this church walks with God? I am all for corporate prayer. I'm for corporate services. That's when we have other people there. But you have to have a secluded time, a time alone with you and God.
Hey.
We had, and I may have told the story before, but we had gone to Texas, and it was 1980-81, and that would have put me as a 10-11-year-old boy. We went down there, worked for Brother Roloff, came back, Dad started the church. Five of us in our Christian school that year. So we basically did our schoolwork, there was no extracurricular stuff, and we were done by 1:15. All my friends didn't get out of school till 3 o'clock. So that gave me about an hour and 45 minutes every day where, you know what it was? Quiet. Nobody around. And Brother Burton, as an 11-year-old, I remember going to my room every day, had my Bible, had my prayer list, and I'm telling you, it was during that year that kind of like when Moses hit the brakes, and God saw it and started to call his name. Brother Paul, God started to work in my heart. And that was a special time. You say, well, when do you really think your walk with God started? In that time when I had that quiet time with God. And the Lord used that. The Lord used that in my life. We have got to have a quiet time. Listen to me. The devil's going to fight your walk with God. Y'all hear me, church? The devil's going to fight your walk with God. You say, why doesn't the devil want us walking with God? Because when you walk with God, and I don't mean this cocky. I don't mean this with any boat. When you walk with God, you're dangerous.
Right.
You're dangerous to Satan. You're a threat. You're a threat. Why? Why is that? Now you've got God involved in your life.
Yeah.
And He's going to work through your life. The question tonight is this: are you walking with God? Well, I'm here. That is not the question. I go to this Christian school. That is not the question. My dad is. That's not the question. I'm a pastor. Are you walking with God? And the devil's going to fight that. And what you could never do on your own, when you're not walking with God, starts to be done in and through your life. Prayer starts to be answered. Absolutely. And God's involved, and God starts to work. Hey, church, Satan doesn't care if you go to church and don't walk with God.
Right.
He doesn't care. You can come here every night of the revival, don't walk with God, Satan ain't going to bother you a bit. It ain't going to matter. Satan doesn't care if you go to Vision Baptist College and don't walk with God. He doesn't care if you teach a Sunday school class and don't walk with God. He doesn't care if you sing specials and don't walk with God. That doesn't bother the devil at all. Hey, I live a Christian lifestyle. Look how I dress. Look at my haircut. Look how I am. But I don't walk with God. Hey, the devil's fine with that. He's fine with that. Who in this place is walking with God? But if you start walking with God, listen, and I promise you it's true, you're going to see miracles. You're going to see victory. You're going to see divine appointments where God is using your life. Church, hey, you'll see the supernatural if you're walking with God. I'm telling you, people who walk with God, it's just the way it is. And God is not someone, listen to me, that I'm just talking about. It's someone that I'm walking with. And when you get to that place in your life, it's not, hey, I'm just watching Him work in a life. No, I'm seeing God doing some of the most amazing things I've ever seen before. And you can have that if you want it. Do you want that? Or we can just know we're saved and go through life as we've always done. Trav used to sing the song, "I Want to Be That Man." Tells the story of a dad who's walking with God. And the son observes, seeking truth. Getting up early. Walking with God, and the young man says of the older man, I want to be like that. Dad, man, woman, older person, is that our testimony that we walk with God? Young people, are you walking with God? Do you want to walk with God? Am I that man? Is it you that's seeking God? This is what you got to do. You got to seek Him out like a treasure. He's not going to hide from you. He's actually going to draw nigh to you. But just as Moses went through, God was there. And He said, hang on. I want to go see this. Listen to me, church. Every day of your life, God, I want to see you.
Yes, sir.
God, I want to see you.
Yes.
In the book, I want to see you. You got to see God. God. I want to hear from you. God, who's really seeking God? And when God saw, look at me, saw that He turned aside, that means He was just going through life doing His thing, but all, and He stopped. Hey, are you just running through life? Are you stopping? Take your shoes off, no problem, I'm here. I'm on holy ground because I stopped, and I'm seeking you. And then God starts to call His name. God gets active in His life. And where was He? He was in a secluded place. Micah 6:8. What's it say? He has shown thee, O man, what is good and what doth the Lord require of thee? To do justly, to love mercy, and here it is, to walk humbly with thy God. Kayla, did you walk the dogs? Yes, I did. That clear.
Right.
Man, woman, teenager, boy, girl, listen to me. Did you walk with God? What's the goal for every one of us? To hear, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." You know the chances of hearing "well done" if we don't walk with God? Zero. So here we are, March 2021. Who's walking with God? We're honest, those who want to. What do I got to do? You have to seek Him. What am I going to do? You have to stop. You got to slow down. You may have to put that phone aside. Click the TV off. Do whatever you have to do. Stop. Slow it down. And then get to that secluded place. Because that's where we walk with Him. And I'm telling you, the miracles you will see, God working in your life, God using your life, God calling your name, we need it. And the devil is totally fine with us doing everything else. Look at my tie, look at my hair, look at how I got my dress on, but I don't walk with him. Go for it. You ain't going to mess up the devil's world at all, because we're just doing it on our own. But I'll tell you what, we start to walk with God, we'll see God work. But know this, the devil's going to fight that. He fights every one of us. But if we're ever going to hear "well done," it's the man, it's the woman, it's the boy, it's the girl that walks with God. Man, life's complicated in 2021. Not as much as we think. Do justly, do right. Love mercy. And here it is. Walk with God. That's what He requires of you and me. Father, we love You. Thank You for tonight. God, I pray that You'd help us. Help me. Well, we know if we're walking with You or not. God, if I'm honest, at times I tell You, Lord, You know how much I love You and You know how busy I am. Forgive me for not walking with You like I should. God, I need to slow down. Lord, if we have not been seeking You, our Bible, our prayer time, I pray that we'd seek You. This is the way Travis was seeking for that money. He was looking for it. God, I wonder who's looking for You. You looked down from heaven and said, "It don't seem like anybody's looking for me." Who's just running around like it said people would do in the last days, running to and fro? No time for God. I'm running. God, help us to stop, be still, and know that You're God. Who is it? And in that secret place, that quiet place, we haven't been showing up. Lord, I pray that there be people here with a desire to walk with You. We'd have Your power. We'd have Your touch. We'd see You work. God, we want to hear "well done." Lord, that won't happen. We're walking by ourselves in our own strength. Help us to walk with You, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Need to come to the altar. Why don't you come? John 20:13, when Jesus was resurrected, Mary went to the tomb and He said, "Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou?" She was weeping because Jesus wasn't there. She was looking for Him, seeking Him. Now, my heart is very tender tonight, thinking about seeking the Lord and being close to Him, and I want Him. And I know God desires you to look for Him. I got a text today from somebody in our church that prayed for me that I walk with God. I said, "I sure will. Pray for me that I walk with God." Brother Mike, I've always wondered, and my kids, I try to put them in a position to walk with God. It's hard, man. It's hard for our kids. But you hit it right on the head, bring it right on the head. Our kids can't be still. Our kids have to have movies, music, things, actions to sit still for 15 minutes. You know what happens to my kids often when they're trying to read their Bibles? Go to sleep. And it's because they may be a little tired. I understand that. But now I'm praying, Lord, help me to combat that, figure that out. But then me too. know, I got to be still and talk to the Lord and get close to Him. And listen, if we did that, we could have Him. And that's just a terrific message. That song she's playing, the beginning of it, I'm not going to sing it. It says, I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses. And that is a morning time. A lot of us don't know anything about that, but if you got touched some grass in the morning time very early, that grass is going to be wet. That's dew. It says, in the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he says, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share while we tarry there, none other has ever known. I want to walk with him. It feels good when you walk with God. I'm just telling you. I can watch some 76ers play and get excited about overtime, and I can watch the Raiders play, and I can watch my son play. Joy of my heart this year has been watching him play for basketball. I can watch Kaylin up here playing on that banjo, or my girl singing, and think, man, that's wonderful. But you know what? None of that compares to the times when I've met with God on a couch in my living room early in the morning. I'm reading and I'm listening and I'm thinking, I'm praying, and I'm like, man, this is awesome. And I get up and say, you know, that was great, Lord. Nothing compares to that. And see, I'm afraid our kids and even adults, we miss that often. Not just our kids. I shouldn't say that. If the kids are missing it, it's because they can't be still. We go buy them all these electronics. All these games of mine have them. They're not saying anything. But I tell you what, I've been a little loose with mine this year. We used to have time limits. We had things like that. We're going to go back to that. My wife's, you know, son, go read a book. Honey, go read a book. You know, stop looking to watch movies and everything like that. I just figured out, man, I've hurt my kids' walk because I've given them too many things to be busy with. So I'm going to combat that, but I'm also not going to be watching them do it. I want to do it. I want them to come downstairs and see Daddy either praying or reading. And not so they can see me, but that's just where I do it at. I'm going to beat everybody up in the morning, get in that word, and walk with them. It's been a great year for me because I've gotten rid of a lot of things and gotten closer to the Lord. I love it. But if I'm not careful, it can slip away just like that with things, people, and busyness. Amen. So thank you, Brother Mike. I appreciate that. What a blessing. And yeah, that was great. That was great. Yeah, God bless you.